This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we have a truly unique guest. He is a dear friend of many years. He is also one of the most remarkable men in the world, and I say that without qualification, because it's quite true. He's a modest fellow, but a fairly modest fellow. Prince Stash Koslowski Dorola, who we call Stash, and I will call him Stash in the show, has an extraordinary life to talk about. He is one of the world's leading authorities on alchemy as it really is. And recently, we have been discussing Gnosticism, and he will probably tell you he is no expert. That would not be true, as you will find later on in the show. I think, Stash, let's start with talking a little bit about what is one of the most remarkable lives I know. Stash is the son of the painter Balthus, one of the 20th century's great artists. Why don't you start by telling us a little bit about Balthus and being his son?
Well, that's a fairly tall order. I actually it was a remarkable thing, but you know, I was born in a family and in circumstances that are more reminiscent of the 18th or 19th century than of the 20th century, because the circumstances are so changed in terms of parents and children. And, you know, our parents were removed at a distance. We didn't deal with them directly. They had, there was staff to go between, and so they were like divinities. We were so privileged to be in their presence. We couldn't really be misbehaving in any way, shape, or form, at least in their presence, as little as possible, because it was moments of extreme privilege. And my father was, you know, my parents were separated fairly early in my life. But it never transpired like a sort of what is vulgarly called a broken home, because we just didn't feel it. They lived in different spheres and in different countries. When my father would appear, there was no, it was just a fantastic experience. And later on, one came to realize that he was uniquely gifted, although there were some dark moments, such as he contracted malaria during his military service in the French army in the late 20s, early 30s. And it stayed with him for the rest of his life. So occasionally he would have accesses of high fever and delirium. And on one such occasion, my brother and I were left alone with him. And he suddenly shouted at us and said, "And if one or the other of you wants to become a painter, I will personally cut off their fingers." And this was, it sounded terribly serious. And,
I can imagine two children it would.
And we were very small, I'm talking about, we were probably around, I couldn't have been more than 5 years old, at the time, and my brother was even younger. And there was a dreadful book that you're probably familiar with this called the Strubelpeter, where this dreadful tailor jumps across a double page to cut the fingers, the thumbs off this kid who sucked his thumbs and was warned by his mother not to do it, otherwise this tailor would come. And so this was, I think this was still during at the towards the end of the war rather than later on. And in this mad world of adults, we thought anything can happen because of such pictures, you know. Because the mother in that story, when she comes, she leaves, the kid ignores her warning, sucks his thumb, and then the tailor cuts not one but both his thumbs. And when the mother comes back, she says, sort of, she doesn't console the crying child who's lost two thumbs. She says, "Well, I told you so."
Yeah, well, those are Germanic stories, aren't they? Yes.
Well, it's a famous book, Der Stubelpeter, it's called.
I didn't ever see and it. My parents were much gentler. We were also raised pretty much by a servant.
If you look it up online, you will see it's absolutely ghastly.
Well, it's
very famous.
I'm certainly sorry for you that you had to experience it and those frights and terrors. But they're part of the underpinning of a man who has made extraordinary advances in the understanding of the esoteric world in a broad sense, and in particular, I think, in the understanding of things like esoteric Christianity and alchemy. But let's move on now to the 60s. You become involved in rock and roll, and you meet people like Mick Jagger. Let's talk about those years and talk about your rock and roll career.
Well, this started like this. In 1959, I was meant to finish high school, and I had a very special education with a writer, an English writer, was my tutor, and he was a very notorious, extraordinary personality called Eric Otto Sipman, who had authored two books, Waterloo on Water Street, because he was involved in the British film business and then went to Hollywood, and also Confessions of a Nihilist. He had eloped with the wife of a lord and was living in this remote part of Dartmoor in a ramshackle Victorian house, Thornworthy House. And he needed the funds that my family was paying him. And so he said, "I'm going to give you the kind of, if you don't say that I'm quite unqualified to teach you the regular curriculum, I will give you an education which you will never forget." And so we started with, you know, the classics and so on in French and in English. The Greek classics and so on, Plato, etc., etc. And I submitted instead of the mathematical papers that were required for Gordonston, I said, "Well, I know nothing about these things, but let me give you an essay on Plato's Republic." They were so impressed with the strangeness of it all that I got accepted to Gordonston. Everybody was extremely proud of me until I discovered, much to my horror, that you had to wear a dreadful uniform, and being a dandy at heart, I thought I'll never be caught dead in such threads. And I now had to undo all the hard work that got me accepted to Gordonston, you know, which was then a very famous school. Prince Charles, who's my junior, would later go on to the same school, but Prince Philip had been there. It's in the north of Scotland. At any rate,
it's a tough, tough. Known as a very tough
Yeah, exactly. So I was very Spartan in those days. You know, swimming in ice cold rivers, riding horses 6-7 hours a day, and so on. And I loved all the physical hardships and that sort of thing. But I couldn't stomach the uniform, which was very hideous and dreadful colors. And I then thought, how can I get out of this? And I thought the only way is if I pretend that my English is absolutely awful. Now, obviously, I couldn't pretend that I didn't speak English, but I could certainly, you know, pretend that I'd learned it completely wrong. Therefore, I would use West Country slang and say, "Was ain't used to this, you know." Us, instead of saying I, I'd say us. Anyway, this is important to show that I then had to promise my parents that I would finish school somehow. And I was sent to Rome to a school called the Overseas School, which had an American program. And I would be in the American 12th grade. And when I arrived there, my mother had accompanied me, and I spent about a week sort of getting the feel of it. But before the fees were paid and everything was settled, I was discovered by Luchino Visconti's assistant. And as I'd promised to finish school, I repulsed all offers to do a screen test and all that until my mother said, no, you should try it. And that's how I ended up entering as a 17-year-old this whole film Dolce Vita world, which led me to being with Fellini at the Cannes Film, 13th Cannes Film Festival, etc. And led me to Hollywood in 1963, in January of 63, and doing a number of interesting things there. But returning to Europe, I couldn't find, in France, in Paris, I couldn't find anything interesting to do. I had a very close friend who was the rock and roll idol Vince Taylor. And he said, "Well, you've always been in the music. Why don't you join my band?" And I took him up on his offer and became a sort of star member of the band because, you know, I had all these gimmicks that nobody had thought of. Strieber had introduced me to glitter, and I wore glitter and had long hair, and you know, the girls had a whole attitude, you know, this sort of uncertain gender type of thing, but with a strong heterosexual bend, which drove the girls very completely crazy. And so I was incredibly successful in that role. And we ended up on the Easter weekend of 1965 playing not opening for, as people now do. We were playing against the Rolling Stones on top of a bill that comprised possibly 10 other acts who were doing one song at a time, and or two or three. In any case, the Stones at the time only did 20 minutes, like we did 20 minutes, and there was the rest of the time was filled by all these numerous acts who were on the same bill. That's how I became friends with Brian Jones and with the rest of the Rolling Stones, which led to my being subsequently introduced to the Beatles and becoming a close friend and collaborating with them in the studio, etc., etc. You know, and I knew everybody, it was anybody in the pop world at that time, from Jimi Hendrix to Donovan to the Who, etc., etc. So, you know, those were all my peers. And after Vince Taylor, this band broke up. We went to America as a different formation. I was offered to be, I was the first person to be offered the lead in what became the Monkees television series. And I turned it down because I hated the script and didn't think that it could possibly, despite my friends Bob Rafelson and Bert Snyder touting it as was going to be Hard Day's Night every week. I thought it was completely lame, to use an American slang term. And I didn't want to be caught in what seemed to be a very long contract. So that's basically the history of how I was involved in all this rock and roll stuff.
Well, we're going to take a little break for our Free Dreamlanders, and we're going to come back. And when we do come back, we're headed to India with Stash, and I think you're going to find it very interesting. We'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle.
We're talking to Stash Klasovsky-Derola. Stash has been telling us about his life in the 60s in the rock and roll world. But you began to journey to take a more spiritual journey, and you at some point you go to India. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, the roots of that are already in my childhood. You know, I had a very strong foreknowledge that came from who knows where, but I knew things as a child that human beings are not usually aware of. And so alchemy was a very strong, you know, I was, when I read disparaging statements about the Philosopher's Stone as a very, very small child, when I learned to read at a very early age, I was horrified and indignant, in fact, without having any basis to be so. So, you know, there was a spiritual component to my wildest ways of my life. I mean, I was reading the Gita, the Bhagavad Gita, when I was in Sri Aurobindo's French translation when I was 10 years old. in school and read up on all the mysteries and all that sort of thing. And in my teens, I'd read, a great influence on my life was the writer Gustav Meyrink, you know, the author of such books as The Golem and The Angel at the Western Window and all these novels. And then I was introduced to Eliphas Levi's work. So, you know, it didn't come out of the blue. Therefore, with psychedelic experiences that came in the rock and roll lifestyle, they led me, especially after traumatic events of 67, they led me to a desire to go on what Hermann Hesse called a journey to the East, or Lama Anagarika Govinda had written a book called The Way of the White Clouds. When I read The Way of the White Clouds, I decided that I absolutely had to sever my obligations, and I was strongly impelled to resign from the band I was currently leading and cancel a major tour and a deal with a major label and so on and so forth, and go off on the road to India. When I got to this place in India called the Dera, in a place called Beas in northern Punjab, at the behest of a mystic called Maharaj Charan Singh, who was the master of that particular, he sent me an invitation and said, come and see me immediately. And when I got there, I was housed in very, very, you know, the quarters for foreign pilgrims were extremely luxurious, and you weren't asked for to spend one red cent about it. This was all you'd made the effort to come. Everything was offered. And during my stay of several weeks at that place, while it was open to foreigners, I, in the library, discovered a book called The Pilgrim's Guide. The Pilgrim's Guide was not meant for foreigners at all. It was meant for sadhus and various pilgrims, and it had an English text as well as a Hindi text, because, you know, English being the lingua franca in India. In it, I read that there was a Swami who led caravans to Tibet on a pilgrimage to the holy mountain Kailash. Now, Tibet was occupied, as it is still today, by the Chinese, but the worst case still was that it was at the height of the Cultural Revolution. Therefore, the whole situation was extremely dicey, but I then elaborated a plan a la Sir Richard Burton, who, as you know, went to Mecca in disguise. Yeah. I decided that I would, in my yogi robes, I would darken my skin with a dye, abandon all my documents and money, and become a deaf mute in order not to have to answer, to speak or answer any questions. And I would be in that caravan going on foot to Kailash, which was probably a 6-week trek from where we would start in Nainital in Uttar Pradesh. Well, when I got to Nainital, a man met me at the bus station and said, "Who have you come to see?" So I declaimed the Swami's name. Whereupon I was invited to dinner, and nothing was said until I'd finished dinner at this man's house. served by his beautiful daughters, at the end of which they broke to me that the Swami had come to see and to join his caravan had just died. Therefore, I was back at square one, but I'd met a man who had explained that Lama Govinda lived above Almora. Now, Almora was in another Himalayan location, but as the crow flew, it wasn't very far, but it took a whole day of riding those rickety public buses from Nainital to Almora, and then a trek of many miles to reach this ridge, at the end of which was the Kasar Devi Ashram, which was occupied by Lama Govinda. Interestingly enough, the house was a gift to Lama Govinda from Evans Wentz, you know, the author of all the Celtic faith.
Yes, you know, exactly. Of all people, it's so improbable.
So I reached the gate of Lama Govinda, and it said no callers until sundown. So I waited in a nearby very small temple, which was completely deserted, and then went at the appointed hour. I presented myself, and Lama Govinda himself opened the door, and I said my name, and he swiveled on his heels, you know, in one extraordinary movement, and reached in one fluid movement, he reached into his bookcase without even looking, grabbed a book, opened it to the right page, and went. And what it was a letter from Rainer Maria Rilke to André Gide about speaking about my family. And there was a footnote with de Roland and this whole history and so on. Yeah, and he said, "De Roland, right? I know exactly who you are," he said.
Rilke, of course, was one of the great poets of the 20th century. He is the author of Duino Elegies, one of the most extraordinary poem sequences written in that century. So, and he turned out to have some kind of a connection with your family, which is so extraordinary.
He was the lover of my grandmother, my paternal grandmother, who in fact, with Rilke, found the castle of Musot in the Valais in Switzerland, where, and she installed it for him, and where he managed not only to finish the Duino Elegies, but also to receive the sonnets to Orpheus in one extraordinary, there's a beautiful letter to her about, "I'm saved," he says to her.
Yes, you know, because of course those poems made him famous.
And there's the published correspondence between my grandmother and Rilke, which is very famous too, the letters to Merline.
Yes. We're going to take another brief break, Free Dreamlanders. We'll be right back.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I worked with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. So, you know, I have to, and we've talked about this before in our private life together. I have to think about where you came from, not in this world, but before, because you seemed, and it's like quite a few people I know in who are deeply involved in things like the alchemical journey. You seem to come into the world already prepared for it. Do you have any sense of past lives, Stash, at all?
I do and I don't. You know, I don't really rely on it that much, but I've had this very strong sense of it, you know, of having and a sense of from early childhood, due to difficult circumstances that did happen with the war and so on, and being away from my parents and placed in supposedly inexpensive places that looked after children, but in fact one was terribly, terribly ill-treated because corporal punishment was widely prevalent at the time, at a very, very young age. I mean, they beat up my brother for breaking another kid's toys when he was 18 months old or something.
Oh my goodness.
I mean, and they beat him very severely with the, you know, not with the hands, but with a stick. And I was so revolted, I tried to run away, all small that I was, but, you know, it was, and go in search of help. But what I mean is that there were dreams of transcendence. There was this sense. And my mother said that she felt when I was born that I knew the answers to certain fundamental questions.
Which you actually do. That would be true. I think I agree with your mother. And we're going to get into that a little bit more deeply. Now, when you were in India, at one point, you found yourself in a forest and you ran across Krishnamurti, of all people.
That wasn't in India.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, that was many years later. No, I was, while I was in India, I was the student of Lama Govinda. But that's interesting. After the meeting I just described to you, while I was there, a very strange figure walked in the room and sat, saluted, you know, with folded hands and sat. And he was dressed in purple robes, purple turban, and so on. He looked to be of European descent, but was in fact an Indian who was indeed, had been a Danish poor peasant who would become a gardener, and the Nehru family had taken him to India. And he was a natural born mystic and was a very famous, became a very famous character that appears in various books by various authors of the time, such as Miguel Serrano, you know, wrote this very, very eloquently about him as the brother of silence. And when we left Lama Govinda's house that on that first occasion, I was wondering where I could possibly stay. Obviously, there were no hotels or anything like that in the vicinity. And he said, "You're far too grand for what I would like to offer." And I said, "Well, whatever. I have my own bedding. I just need an awning to sleep under or something." And he then presented me with a hall, with a house that he'd built with his own hands, beautiful gardens, another meditation pavilion, etc. And that was next door to his own home. And there I, you know, due to the generosity of this incredible man who had a huge influence on me, on his entire philosophy was extremely important. He is the one who coined the term inner standing, which I'm so fond of, and many other variations on the English language, which were marvelously apt. And he was known as Shunyabai, you know, from and his philosophy was Shunyata, and he would attribute all his sayings to a little dog called Wuji. So he was very humble at the same time. And so, you know, there I lived, and there I went on my various pilgrimages before going to Nepal and being involved with various Buddhist personalities and studying in various monasteries, etc., and only returning to the West. And I was also the assistant to a High Lama who organized means of funding the Kampa rebel resistance and so on. And it was a fascinating time. That's how I became a collector of Indian and Tibetan antiquities.
You also have a marvelous collection of alchemical texts as well.
Well, that came, yes.
Go ahead.
That came about because when I returned from India, I had a strong yen to once again sharpen my love for alchemical text, which had begun previously. I mean, I used to go to the British Library, which was housed in the British Museum, as you know, and I would copy in longhand alchemical texts because it was one of the ways to learn. And there's a Latin saying, qui scribit bis legit, meaning he who writes reads twice. And you know, it was a recommended exercise. And I used to do that even before this my journey to the East and so on. When I returned, I wanted to do something about a certain very famous manuscript, which at the time was nobody had explored, the Splendor Solis manuscript in the British Museum, which is the best of a whole series. And I went to Albert Skira, who was a friend of my father's, who in turn sent me to London to look at this famous manuscript. And I became friends with Derek Turner, who was the keeper of manuscripts at the British Library in the manuscript department. And Derek Turner sent me to Thames and Hudson about this project, which they found fascinating. But while they were waiting to speak to Skira about terms, etc., they offered me, they said, we are starting a new series. There's only two there's the first three titles are going to appear. We'd like you to do the Alchemy one in their new collection called Art and Imagination. And indeed, that gave me a fantastic possibility and the credentials to go to all the great manuscript libraries in the whole of Europe, from, you know, German, various German libraries and the French ones and the Italian ones, especially the Vatican Library. And I put together this vast compilation, which was distilled into my first book, Four Thames and Hudson, called Alchemy, the Secret Art. Whereupon, which was published in 73, whereupon I did a French version of it, which was completely different. I mean, it was the same pictures, but a completely different text. Because I was introduced to the famous alchemist Fulcanelli, and Fulcanelli's one living disciple was a man called Eugène Cancelier. Eugène Cancelier was a practicing alchemist. He called himself the oldest student in France. He was an elderly man, and he taught me, and he became my very close friend with a capital F, which is what you need for initiation into the arcana of this sort of thing. And thanks to him, I was able to approach the Fulcanelli material in a completely different manner. And to proceed with my alchemical studies in a completely different manner, which led to the publication in 74 of the French version of this of that book, which was far more advanced, called Alchimie, Florilège de l'Art Secret. I then, Thames and Hudson asked me to do something about copperplate engravings. And I looked around, and so I signed the contract. And I looked around looking for an instrument which didn't exist. And I was fairly reliant. It was an enormous task. And again, I had to do a tremendous amount of research. And in order to penetrate and to look at these things with ancient eyes, I had to go into very profound meditative state, which was facilitated by my having discovered in 1971 a small island south of Sri Lanka, where I ended up living for 10 years. During those years, I worked incessantly on that project. And it was with being steeped in a place that was marvelously geometrical, extremely luxurious in terms of amenities, of beauty, and so on, but no electricity. And this lack of electricity was a key factor on an island in an octagonal palace to be able to come up with extraordinary realizations filled with harmony. And it led me to this book that has been highly praised, which was it took 10 years before it was actually published. It was published in 88, the first edition of it, both in England and in America. And in America, it sold at once. And what its premise is was that I was again, terribly attracted to the graphic expression of these secrets, you know, these
the
alchemical
secrets. The images themselves have power.
The images themselves have an incredible power, and according to all the classic texts, much more is revealed therein than in any text using words. And the principle for that I was to discover in my research was that, was oddly enough, I looked up why did they call them emblems and why did they call them hieroglyphs. So investigating the latter term, hieroglyph, I found out that, you know, the Renaissance discovered hieroglyphs with a manuscript which was found in 1422 by an agent of Cosimo the Elder de' Medici on the island of Andros. And that was the Hieroglyphica of Horopolo, which was a bit of a fantastic work, but the importance of it cannot be understated because it was the means by which the Renaissance interpreted these things. And Dürer illustrates, you know, there's extant an incredible amount of copies from the 15th century. And it was, so much was done. Dürer illustrated it and so on and so forth. And really, the emblem tradition was then born, you know, from that. It's the direct filiation. And it was so interesting that the alchemists developed the emblem tradition in their own way. People such as Michael Mayer, who was the physician to Rudolf II, who was ennobled and was a practicing alchemist, whose many books are incredibly valuable, including he published the first very rough publication called Arcana Arcanissima, which was published at London. I found the proof of that, that it was London and not Germany, inadvertently by, you know, these extraordinary things that happen in one's life. I was sitting in the North Library at the British Museum when they delivered to me something I hadn't requested at all. They came with to my desk, and when I looked at this book, it was a Frankfurt Book Fair catalogue of the 17th century, which contained exactly the proof I needed. That my feeling about the Arcana Arcanissima was, you know, the proof of it was irrefutable in that particular catalogue, which I never thought even of requesting. And it came spontaneously to me in this marvelous synchronicity, as I love to call synchronicity. It was synchronicity. No, and so Michael Mayer in 1617 published the first edition of a masterwork called Atalanta Fugiens, the fugitive Atalanta, that was the first multimedia book because it used image, epigram, music, and then discourse. And epigrams were in German and in Latin, and the discourse itself was in Latin, and the music is marvelous. A friend of mine, Jocelyn.
In alchemy, who is Atalanta?
Atalanta?
Yeah.
Atalanta, you know, she was very swift. She said that she could not be beaten at a foot race. And a man called Hippomene was given by Venus, was displeased by her dedication to virginity. So she gave golden apples to Hippomene. And while Hippomene ran and Atalanta would catch up, she would drop one of those golden apples. Atalanta couldn't resist stopping to pick it up. And in the end, she lost the race, which she should have easily won because she picked up all three of the golden apples and lost the race and was for, Hippomene won her hand. But then they went into a temple and had intercourse in this temple, offending the gods who folded them into one being, a hermaphrodite being. And so this is obviously a completely, it's all of this sort of mythologies and an analogy and correspondence, of course. So you learn, and that's when it was so useful on the island of Taprobane in Sri Lanka, then Ceylon. It was a great way to develop these inner skills, to develop the intuition, to develop this language. And what I did was in the process, my aspiration was to develop antique, what I called antique eyes, ancient eyes, in order to see it, not, you know, from a modern critical point of view. I was well aware of all the critical problems with alchemical literature, but I chose deliberately to ignore it and see it the way the alchemists did. And in so doing, I gained an inner standing of it that had not been imparted to many, many people who just concentrated on the external factors and ended up, and alchemy fell into this rather dreadful psychological distortion, because Carl Gustav Jung, whom I absolutely revere, however, used his initial studies of alchemy to bolster his own theories rather than elucidate alchemy. And as a result,
what it actually is,
as a result, he deviated quite a lot from a more traditional approach. And it has been, of course, the symbolism is polyvalent, so it lends itself to a different interpretation, but it cannot be mistaken for the original intentions of the authors, which and Jung's followers have therefore had a dreadful influence on the whole discipline, because academics have often resorted to looking at Jung's interpretations rather than having given up on what seemed to them a completely absurd premise.
And yet there is something there that's quite powerful. The journey of alchemy, the real journey, is about achieving a kind of oneness, I think would be the best way to put it, with who we really are and the world we live in. And it's not an intellectual journey exactly. It's a journey in symbolism. Can you talk a little bit about that and some of the symbols?
Yes, well, the fundamental thing is that you learn with practical alchemy that the object is to create a very pure substance which acts as a magnet on a mysterious influx that occurs at a very precise moment in during the spring, which, if captured, say like you know, like if we're using a crystalline, a crystal set. I mean, most people, you and I, our generation used crystal sets to receive radio waves, etc. It operates on a similar principle, except that rather than just acting as a mere receiver, in this case, it's like a beautiful woman which acts as an erotic magnet, and I mean this, as an erotic magnet to that mysterious spirit of life that is so intangible and so fugitive that it doesn't, you cannot, if there's any interference in the weather, etc., you can't actually do this. So it's an art form, and it's not repeatable necessarily, although you might know everything about it. But the long and short of it is that you're dealing with not only a spiritualization of matter, but conversely, a materialization of spirit. At which point, matter acquires extraordinary properties that go beyond, that transcend the ordinary rules of physics and nature. And you end up with extraordinary properties. Now, this is very important to be aware of this because the so-called elaboration of the Philosopher's Stone very much depends on that ultimate realization, which allows one to then proceed in different manner. The texts fall short of the full implication of that mystery in saying that by the multiplication, if this Donum Dei, this gift of God, is achieved, you will then have the possibility of transmuting base metals into gold, which is not a very interesting application because physical wealth is not the except to relieve poverty and so on, is not really the goal of that discipline. Curing all ills, a sort of universal medicine, is a great possibility, and that extending one's physical existence on Earth by a huge span could also be interesting. But the one unspoken and ultimate quality is what you were alluding to, is, as it were, to attain a point of development of that spark of light within oneself, which then expands into one's entire being and provokes a sort of universal wisdom whereby one, at one and the same time, one knows no thing and one knows everything because the attention can be directed on anything and be given an instant answer to any given subject instantaneously. So that
you're
ultimate
an adept at that point is what you're saying.
The adeptship. Adept means he who has attained,
yes,
in that sense.
Wow.
And that dovetails very well with our Gnostic studies, which we partake into
Yes, Stash and I are members of a small group who are studying the Pistis Sophia in the Book of the Savior. So, but we've come to the end of the first hour. Amazingly, it seems like we've been talking for 10 minutes. It's been so very interesting. And before we go, I would like to ask everyone, Free Dreamlanders, to subscribe. But subscribers, tell your friends about the show and about Unknown Country, because there's nothing like it in the world. And we're drifting slowly downward in terms of subscriptions. So we need new people. And you will never hear this, a show like this, anywhere else on any other show, simply for one simple reason. There, no one knows guests like Stash as well as I do, and also doesn't know how to ask them questions, but I do understand this. Now, when we move on, we're going to move on into Gnosticism, but first we're going to talk about a little bit about the energies of Tantra, which Stash alluded to a little earlier, because these are the energies that dovetail with the alchemical journey, and it is the use of these energies that enables you to become truly an inner alchemist. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.